Today is a good opportunity to not talk about technology, to not talk about APIs at all, to talk about something that is way more fundamental, crucial for change towards digital. But at first, I'm visiting conferences, keynote talks, and speaking and panels and all over the world, and so I clicked. Why? How? How does that work? So, okay. I didn't want to click, but it's perfect now. I brought you something from the last conferences I visited, so attended. Back. It's very sensitive. The customer journey to buy a new washing machine takes exactly 48 hours. Whatever you think, I think this is very special because we have a deep in mind an idea of a washing machine and what we buy once it's broken. But in the moment it's broken, we only have 48 hours to make a decision, regardless what product is on the shelf. So it's really hard to fight for a product if you are in the washing machine business. It's really exciting for me. So another thing, there are stunning ways of thinking big. Actually, this company, who is as well in washing machines, is prepared this cool marketing thing, and they created this big washing machine, put people in. It's really foamy thing. It's a really deep experience of foam and being inside a washing machine. It's not about faking it. It's just making it. It's a direct contact to the product. This is amazing, and this is why I brought this to you. And I learned about Hank and Ryan. This is prototypical for traditional customer and a new customer. And for people who are creating shavers, they experience that the new customers have a complete new expectation because they are wearing different beards, short hair everywhere. They're even shaving their heads with a shaver. It's something completely different than a traditional customer who is always blankly shaved and everything is bald and nicely neat and clean. So they had to invent a new product. And so they said, consumers have evolved, yet their tools have not. And I, the digital journeyman, just listened to it and said, this is something that sounds familiar. I translated it to, consumers have evolved, yet our organizations have not. And this is visible and seeable everywhere. And from Hank's perspective, technologies have evolved, yet we have no clue on how to use them. It's about shavers, and in the end, it's about everything. It's a daily drama again. And I learned about the perfect product. You can see it here. Any guesses what it is? No, I don't think so. I think for me, the perfect product is this, the banana. I really appreciate, I love the product manager who designed this perfect product regarding packaging, regarding taste, regarding everything. I think it's gotten made, so he's a perfect product manager. So, and of course, I learned, again, one thing. This is a statement saying by Sam Walton from Walmart that there's only one boss, the customer. He can fire everybody from top to down in the organization only by not buying the product. For example, banana. Everybody is buying bananas. So, this term customer, I think on every office aisle you will see at least one, two, three times on every keynote speech, on any internal thing, on every slide deck, you will find something like, we have to be more customer-centric. So you are bombarded with something like customer-focused, customer-centric, and it's all about the customer. But what is really true? Since we are organized in horizontal layers and no one of us is somehow in contact to the customers, just a weird group of business people is able to get in contact to a customer. We are doing something for we don't know. And so, does everyone in your organization really breathe customers? Direct contact, breeze to breeze, eye to eye. And even better, is there anybody in this room, Andrea, I know you will say something soon, who truly loves his customers? Say it.
I love my customers.
He loves his customers, and this is the expectation who proves the term, the whole thing. So, in most of the organizations, the customer is not relevant at all. I've been as a software engineer and so many roles in huge organizations. And somehow we weren't talking about the customer. This is just for internal, this is just for this or that, but there is no customer. And if you're working, for example, for a big insurance company and there is a big financial crisis, you're looking out of the window and just waiting until it's over, because they have got so much money, they don't realize anything. So customers are not relevant for the most organizations. It's exciting. And somehow it works, because our competitors are as bad as we are. So this is fair again, and so we can drive our business as we do it, as seen, as described. And from my perspective, this whole customer-centric, customer-facing thing of our organization lives only on sticky notes, whiteboards, and maybe on keynote slides. But the real contact to the customer is most of the times missing. Somehow, we have to rethink our pretzels. I love this, rethink your pretzels. I think this describes it best. We have to rethink it all. So let's talk about change. Everybody is talking about change, and I step into the same shoes, and let's talk about change. Maybe from a different perspective, because I'm not only a software engineer, I'm a systemic coach, and so I'm thinking about change, and I'm talking about change. So you as a person, as an individual, as well as your organization, is a living system. It's as easy as that. So we behave like an organ. That's why we are called organization. And there is something typical to living systems. There are four aspects of change. So let's challenge the status quo. You can separate four quadrants of any little living system. So let's start. The upper left corner is a mindset, the individual mindset, my ideas, what to do next, when I go to work, when do I have to go to sleep, whatever, and what could I build next. Upper right, behavior and communication. Let's go further. Lower right, technologies, structures. Everything, new technologies, structures, our organization structures, there you find the reorg once this is evolved. You find it over and over again in technology and structures. And some really weird, this is a corporate, the living systems culture. And everything, always three of them are something making the fourth. So if we want to evolve here, maybe let's assume our organization gets a message, we have to digitize, we have to become a software company in some way. So what we can do best, we are facing technology and structures. We make a little reorg here, and we buy some, now I say it again, API management platform, for example. So this is safe. This is what we can do best. But everything else keeps the same. And if you look into your organization, I think you will see, prove me that I'm false, that if you're only doing that, you will reproduce the same status quo again using this technology and this structure. This happens over and over again, and then it gets more expensive and it takes even longer. It's the opposite from the promised outcome. Mindset, changing the mindset of evolving here is so difficult, it's a private thing. We won't do that. It's too difficult, and somehow it's pathologic. Behavior communication, this is yoga stuff. Maybe we attend a workshop on communication, non-violent communication. Okay, we're in it, but in the end, this is not real stuff. This is nothing technical here. Okay, and there's another point, it's the culture. And there is a psychological term called double bind. It means if you do, you have to decide between A and B. So if you choose A, B, you will be punished. If you choose B, you will be punished. And so now please decide. And so cultural thing, my double bind, I'm running in everywhere, is something like, you're allowed to change everything unless you don't change anything. So this never, never change our culture. I think this is the theory around it. And to get out of this, I'm experienced, and I'm thinking about two ways to get to a two-track way to get out of this. So, and it's not either or. We have actually to do it both. My last keynotes were only facing on the left one, track one. Now I added the second one because I think this is way more important in our changing time. So, track one is targeting your current employees, everyone in your company, and track two, all your future employees, because you don't want to start again with the current employees and do it again and again. So we have to make it more sustainable in the end. And they are inseparable. Right click. How to break your organization's habits to avoid change. So, if you're a coach, you will learn that change usually comes with irritation. You have to irritate a system, disturb it, and then it's able to reorder itself to something hopefully better. So, good, so let's get irritated. We'll make a test here. Irritated? This boom here? Not really, it's a small irritation. No value in it. Let's try something else. Oh, okay, this is an irritation. So, you better make some noise to change your company's digital or DNA. It's about noise. It's about a huge, impactful irritation. So, let me introduce, prototypically, your corporate nightmare. This break now is really important. This is Pippi Longstocking. I think most of you know Pippi Longstocking is a longtime hero of mine, my childhood hero, and it's still something, it's a role. This is perfect to describe what we really need here. Who doesn't know Pippi Longstocking? One, oh, so many, okay, okay. It's an figure, it's a children figure from many books, from Astrid Lindgren, a Swedish author, I think from 1956, the first started, and she is a really wild girl with a father, something, he's a pirate captain, and she enters a little village in Sweden, and this is really keen and neat, and everybody's very friendly, and she gets friends there, their neighbors in her little villa, and she teaches them how to live and how to break rules. I think this is a quite good summary. So this is a Google office in Stockholm, a room name. My friend Matt Chalmers sent it to me, and I think even the idea of Pippi is arrived as well at Google. So let's go deeper into the characters. Pippi, her friend, neighbors, this is neighbors, the neighbors Annika and Tommy, and you've got Pippi, and she's always going forward, doing everything, but Annika's always very, oh, shy, we can't do this, we have to ask mommy and all this stuff, and Tommy is really, he loves what Pippi is doing, but he asks again Annika if it's right or it's wrong. So we've got, in the end, our organizational structure built from HR, in the end, is somehow Tommy and Annika, and we don't have any Pippis at all. Or we don't have them very long because we will spit them out because they are irritating. So let's rethink this. Pippi has superpowers, is courageous, is curious, is positive, is a natural-born leader. She's unstoppable. She's thinking not only big, she's thinking huge, and she can make anything just happen. Just anything. This sounds good, and this is a driver for change. Absolutely. So, thinking further with this Pippi idea, oh, getting more serious now for me, she's a perfect synthesis of talent, self-confidence, of course insanity, because you have to be somehow insane, and humbleness, because she has her soft sides. And these are the same important than everything else. And since every business is a digital business, and adapt or die was never meant to be a joke, somehow we have to Pippify our organizations. And this is what I truly mean. We have to Pippify our organizations and our businesses. Otherwise, the second term from adapt or die will be true someday. So, now something practical, how to find the right people to gain digital momentum. I created the Pippi Longstocking approach. Next time you're interviewing somebody for the new team, not HR, don't let HR do it. This is not bashing HR, because it's about you have to do it, because he or she should fit to you. And so you can maybe follow this, make a photo and print it, and you take this little thing here. You've got a Pippi scale and you've got an Annika scale. And right from the things I described before, you've got this superpower and we can make it happen stuff, and all this is on the Pippi scale, and you've got the Annika scale, oh, better not. Or whatever voice it's needed to act it. And if you're interviewing your interviewee really hard, you're just feeling the energy, how much Pippi comes to you and how much Annika. And then I've got a little description here, something like a scale in the end. The winning rule for digital success is Pippi greater than 6, Annika less than 5. And of course, the opposite, HR's choice would have been Pippi less than 4 and Annika greater than 5. So, and just for security reasons, I just mentioned this. If you see Pippi below and Annika below 3, call an ambulance. This is dangerous. Okay. This was track 1. Facing the existing people in your organization. But now, this little addition that I brought up especially for this amazing conference. It's boiling in my mind for months, I think even for years, but now it's ready to be here. It's about our society, and it's about a special part of our society. So, imagine our school times. There are three top skills we learned in school. So, guess the super skill number 1, please. 1 or 2? You're not sure? I'm going to help you. Number 1. Absolutely, the absolute top winner is sitting. Look at you. We are sitters. We are super sitters. And we know how to sit, and we can sit so long without even moving and being all this. Oh, we are so great sitters. Okay, we've got a number 2. I don't let you guess. I think it's too easy. It's about being conform. Of course, we have to be conform for years in our preschool, elementary, whatever, and then in the university, you have to be somehow conform all the time, and we are learning this, and we are behaving like that. And we've got a number 3, please never stand out. Shh, it's too loud, be quiet. Don't show up, don't get your head out of the hole, otherwise somebody will shoot you. I think it's a basic instinct to not stand out. So, this is a highway to mediocrity. If we really embrace these skills, we will. It's directly leading to mediocrity. Okay, this is one way to live. Maybe there are other ways to live. Maybe we get to this point. Would you expect from somebody like this, I mentioned before, on the highway to mediocrity, come up with a great product? I think this is a no. It's really hard. If this is part of your DNA, you wouldn't ever come up with a great product, because great means standing out. And this is actually the place where I found this in a slightly different way. The competition of knowledge is dead. From now on, it's the competition of creativity. I'm watching a lot of videos from Jack Ma, and I'm feeling supported by him. Because now something, the CEO of Alibaba is pushing me and saying, Kai, you're on the right path. And he says, this whole stuff we learned in school is something, this accumulation of knowledge, this whole right brain stuff, remembering stuff, math, algorithms, will be done by AI in the near future. So what is our part? He says, computers have bits, humans have hearts. This sounds esoteric, but he's right. Of course, we have to see where is our piece of the cake in the future. And we won't see it in our current organizations if we proceed to do it like we've done it before. Pippi could help here. This is one thing. But we need lots of Pippis. Whenever you are searching or looking for something like Pippi on LinkedIn, you won't find nobody. Exactly nobody. I've tried it sometimes. No answer at all. Because this again means standing out, and we don't want to do that. So, feeling supported by Mr. Jack Ma, I proceed. Back in 2005, In parallel to my whole IT business, my three children at that time, and my whole thing, I opened extreme sports, unicycle supply, and whatever, juggling high-talented, gifted children shop right in the middle of Hamburg. And so I was on a railway track, and 50 meters from me, there was a guy, black, dreadlocks, weird clothes, sitting on a 26-inch unicycle with tires like that and smiling at me. And I will never forget that smile, because this was a guy, whenever he entered a room, there was no light needed, because he just enlightened the room, and I learned a lot from him. From this moment, we became friends, and he lived 2.5 years in our house with all my wife, my children, two cats and one dog on 100 square meters in Hamburg. This was an amazing time. But this is Aaron Ashby. And Aaron Ashby was something very special on him. And at some point, I figured out what it is. And he was able to talk to his CEO the same way than to a rioting group of young people in the train that are crying around. He just came to them, talked to them. And the next moment, he talked to a man on the street and said, how are you doing? But in such an eye level I've never seen before. And at one point in our 2.5 years, I realized what this was. And he visited a different school in Seattle, where he came from originally. And this was so amazing. And then I found such a school in Hamburg. I'll come back to this later. Let me ask you, are you sitting here voluntarily? Is this, yeah? Who is forced to come here? Nobody. Okay, so let's have a look at our children. They are forced to go there. And you will learn if you're not forced to go to some place, and if you're just following rules. And this is the reality in our schools for most of our children. I'm talking about three of my children now. I've got a 5-year-old as well, so I'm experiencing this again. It didn't take 1 year. We didn't have to wait for 1 year unless these highly creative little kids were somehow bored and frustrated and said, I don't want to go there and all this stuff. I think if you have children, you have to experience something like this as well. So. And this, again, if we are forcing our children to join such schools, this leads again to mediocrity, not stand out, just doing the go with the flow, not disturbing at all. And being bored is a skill again. I can be bored the whole day long. This is okay for me. So let's have a dream. Let's imagine a school where you found mentors instead of Mr. and Mrs. We are always right, our teachers, always. The power from above. He or she is always right, and I'm always wrong. Well, it's up to you what to learn and when, regardless when. In the middle of the night, in the middle of the day, on the weekend, and what to learn, it depends on your idea. If I say, if I'm 8 years old, I want to know everything about quantum physics, I walk to my mentor and say, tell me everything about quantum physics. He will teach me exactly that. Or he'll find somebody who is able to teach me that. Where everyone has one voice, lived democracy. We can't even imagine what it means to experience lived democracy. If everybody is sitting in a room, everyone has one voice from the very beginning. And where you are no longer stuck in age silos. 8 years old can ask a 14-year-old girl, can you please help me doing this or that? Are you exciting in doing this? Otherwise, you will see, if you're 14 or 16, you will see an 8 years old and say, you know so much about quantum physics, please teach me. This is not possible in traditional schools, and it's lived experience in democratic schools. Where hanging around is absolutely okay. Our assumption is if somebody is hanging around or using the swing, that he's not working because it's fun. And you're learning while swinging, of course. And you're walking, learning while chatting, and you're learning while hanging around. While you're as a human being, where you're complaining about summer holidays, but in the other ways, they are too long. Imagine that. They are too long, not too short. And where you stay longer at school as you have to. and where you are encouraged to work in social projects from day one. Coming back to Aaron, he worked in a hospital. As a little boy, he helped in a hospital. How cool is that? And I think one reason why I met such a guy was this school in the end. And the idea of this school is originated in Sudbury Valley near Massachusetts, and this is, for me, it's just a model. And many schools on Earth, I think there are hundreds right now, but usually never in the place where you live or even close to that. So I found one for Jeremy, my oldest son, and it was Neue Schule Hamburg in Hamburg, of course, Germany. And I was a sports teacher there for, I think, 1.5 years, and I learned so much about learning and about the right way to teach. And it's an unimaginable experience to work at such a school with such children. And, of course, I know my voice. The voices in my brain, in my head, they tell me, oh, that can't be true. They are just hanging around, they are doing this. They are not, they won't be ready for the next exam. And they are always on their own will. And this is amazing. So, Neue Schule Hamburg, it's already existing. My plan for 2019. It's not only pipifying organizations or help to find the right people or do whatever is needed for the current employees. It's about making dreams come true. I'm talking years of that, but now I think I try to find alliances to make this happen. And I'm going to show you one more picture, what really moved me. I think the picture was taken 2.5 years ago or 3 years. This is Mr. Barack Obama, just in kindergarten, looking into this window with the children. Imagine if they grow up, what they say if they see themselves watching Barack Obama at this point. So this person not only using this or view this picture is really influenced me. I want to see the Barack Obama School in Zurich, exactly a Sudbury Valley School. I want to organize it all, and I think this is for a person who works in the digital world and is digitalizing companies and talking about technologies, of course, APIs and this stuff. We have to really empower our children to get ready for the digital future. Otherwise, what shall they do in this digital future? And it will arise very, very soon. So, closing it up. Closing the circle. It's about pipification. It's one thing I never mentioned before. It's personal development. If you've got any time to change something in your life, visit a group that is engaged in personal development to really ramp up your ideas, maybe get out of this trap of learning of our ideas, of ourselves. I'm limited to this, I can't do this, I can't do this and that and all this stuff. If you can grow from within, I think this is a really good step. Pipification, bring such persons again in your organization and work or create or found or help or be partner to create new schools. It's about you to do something. Means personal development, maybe pipify yourself, I love that one, or visit a school that's already existing, or help to open another school somewhere else in your country, in your town, wherever. Thank you.